Hello, Malty, mindless malt mechanics, and thank you to Hilatopa 90s for that malt mention introducing a whisky review number 596. And I'm Ralphie, this is the Manx Bothy, this is the whisky I'm going to review. You'll be pleased to know that this is generally quite available, generally quite affordable, and really quite tasty as well, in its own characterful and singular way. It's called Balvenie 12-year-old First Fill Single Barrel Whisky, bottled at 47.8%, so a good strength, and as you can see for yourselves, malt mates, it's a pretty natural colour. That isn't a colour created by caramel colourant. It is the natural colour of a whisky, light barley straw colour, and all the better for it. I have reviewed a similar whisky back 2 years ago in Whisky Review 434, around about February 2014, and it is not the same bottle, because this is single barrel versions. So although it's a similar whisky, it's from a different barrel, which makes it that little bit different. So this isn't a re-review of a whisky I've already reviewed, as it would be if it was a standard bottling, because this is essentially one barrel is bottled, and then once it's out in the shelves, they're on to the next barrel. It gets bottled. And they confirm this by giving you a cask number and a bottle number. And for those of you who really want to know exactly what I'm reviewing and tasting here and presenting to you, this is cask number 5862, says it on the label. Lovely label, informative, as is the box, by the way. It tells you about barrels, the names of the barrels, the rivets, the bilges, the staves, the barrel heads. Tells you all about it, and that's useful, good information, practical stuff, and I do commend Balvenie for doing this. However, the final assessment, what really matters is the smell and the taste. So what have we got here? Something similar to the Balvenie 12-year-old single barrel that I reviewed in Whisky Review 434. Yes, it is similar. It's got a lot in common, but it's still different because it's from a different barrel. And what I'm noticing in this compared to the last one, as much as I remember of it, is this is altogether drier. It's got less of a sweet edge. Now, Balvenie has never been a sweet whisky in its standard 12-year-old format. It's floral, it's unpeated, it's got a nice intrinsic slightly herbal complexity to it, and we love that stuff. And always a good strong vanilla throat note through it, particularly suits a bourbon cask maturation, does Balvenie. But here, it's quite in your face, well, quite up your nose, and quite dry. The nose leads straight on to the palate. As soon as you take a sip, oh my goodness, the bitterness, the sourness. Ooh, it's delicious. But it's a bit of a shock to the senses, particularly in first contact if you've never had a whisky like this before. It has barley bitters about it, coming from the spirit itself, rather than the cask. The cask, incidentally, is contributing a little bit of sweetness in the background. Not such a lot, though. But this is essentially a bitter, sour malt. I'm adding two teaspoonfuls to a small standard glass, because in my opinion, it really needs it. The first experience of this whisky is going to leave you slightly feeling as if you're sucking on a lemon, a bitter lemon at that, with plenty of rind in it and a little bit of mild spice and a sort of herbal notes as well. It's just that kind of whiskey, the same bitterness as you get occasionally with Old Pulteney. It's uncompromising. If you prefer sweet, mellow whiskies, you don't want this. You don't. This is not that kind of whiskey. However, it's interesting to note that when people are exposed, maybe had a few couple of years drinking whiskey, are exposed to really astringent, demanding, dry, almost minerally flinty styles of single malt, like this Balvenie single barrel. The first experience is a bit of a shock to the senses, but thereafter, as the senses get used to it and the brain gets used to the experience of this unusual range of smells and smell and taste sensations, the bitter, the sour, the little touch of salt in the background, not a lot, but it is slightly saline in the background. Once the brain gets used to interpreting these signals from the nose and from the tongue, it'll actually settle down and you will start to enjoy the experience more, although it is not everybody's cup of tea. Or, well, I should have said it's not everybody's single malt. That's just the nature of it. But I've added 2 teaspoonfuls of water now, and immediately in the nose, big change. That harshness is gone. There's still dry, still sour in the nose, but it's mellowed out and it's brought in a certain complexity as well that's already there but masked by these strong notes. And so we're getting some fresh fruit, slight yeast, some ginger, some herbal notes too, some bitter herb, gentian, wormwood, a little touch of fennel, a little touch of sage, and something the astringent, which I like in a whiskey. I like astringency, but a touch of aromatic as well. There's a little bit of cola cube and pear drop in the background. And interestingly, as time goes on in the glass, I notice more of a peach note. Very pleasant. The nose becoming much more kinder to your senses. And the taste, well, that happens too. The additional water, I cannot over suggest that you really want to explore all this. Never just carry on just drinking whiskey neat from the bottle as is, as you've been advised by many drinkers, because you're just not getting the full experience. If you don't want the full experience, it's your choice. Oh, it's more like it. Much more paced and measured arrival, more complex, far more accessible than drinking it neat. That bitterness and sourness, particularly the sourness, has significantly subsided. There is more of a barley sugar sweetness, vanilla sweetness in there, something of influence of the cask. And that cask has been very influential. It's not for no reason that Balvenie are stating on the label first fill, and they've underlined it first fill. They want you to know that the cask that they use to mature this liquor in has previously matured bourbon, but not Scotch whiskey, not another Scotch whiskey. So it's a what you call a fresh cask. It's got that maturation in the wood from the bourbon. It's got a little bit of bourbon residue still in the cask, still ingrained in the wood. It's softened, it's mellowed, it's sweetened, but it's flavorful cask. It's got loads to give to the spirit. And that's why in a younger age, in this case 12 years old, you're getting plenty of maturation, and it shows from the slightly smaller casks. And also what I'm getting is that it's been one cask for the full journey of 12 years. This hasn't been cask jumping or cask hopping between different casks to beef it up, which can be a perfectly legitimate thing to do if it's done carefully and for the right reasons. Flavour, slightly sweeter. Beautiful mocha note in there. A little bit of chocolate. S complex arrival, complex herbal notes. Nasturtium and gentian, I'm really picking out, and sage. Some dry herbal notes. Beautiful floral notes, some freesia, lily of the valley. always the background to Balvenie. It's an intrinsically complex whisky, and interesting to note, it's one that seems to mature to a grand old age very successfully, rather like Macallan and Glen Grant. Balvenie is one of these malts that can really go the distance in terms of maturation. It can only really do that if it's got the substance, the character to begin with, rather like a Mortlacher, an old Glen, old style Glengoyne. Exquisite pear drop note, confectionery pear drop note, slight cola in it, infused with those herbals. For a 12-year-old whisky, this is showing a remarkable complexity of spirit. It really is. It's delightful. What am I going to give it? A malt mark. Yes, we need to give it a malt mark. It's important. Let me see now. Some malt mates out there, you probably know them, will come to this whisky and have a quick glass. What is a quick glass? A quick glass is this. I'm not sure if I like it. And it's a bit bitter. Ugh. That's a quick glass. Whoever, wherever, whatever, when you're dealing with a whisky like this, and many other whiskies and other spirits, you're not going to get anywhere until you have a slow glass. Not a quick glass. The slower you go, the more substance to the experience. Here we are. Arrival. Development. Finish. Complex, clean, substantial, flavoursome, busy on the nose, particularly in the palate, very busy, well matured, nicely presented, a higher strength, a natural colour, a quality whisky, and affordable and available. The slow experience, pacing it out, undisturbed, with friends or on your own, just whatever, will give you so much more of an experience. Modern life is full of rush, consumption and rush. People are encouraged to rush, to work harder, work longer, work more, demand more, spend more, think less. These social pressures, they've always been there, they always will be. But a glass of single malt is a really good vehicle to allow you to kind of step off the away from the pace. And we don't even realise it, but our brains are going at a faster pace than they should, missing so much of what's around us, missing the detail, missing the messages that are strewn on the pavements of our cities and towns. But that's another story. And you will come across whisky drinkers that they're in a rush for the experiences, because as soon as you finish one whisky, you can then move on to the next. And this is one of these whiskies where people will make judgments too hasty. They've not spent time with it. They've not added the water and given it time to open up, settle down, chill out, mellow up. As a result of which, they just don't see what's going on. There's one reason why I'm here, to kind of share the practical experience of drinking the whiskey with you, and just reminding you, I'm sure you already know, but just reminding you to slow the pace down. Even if you have a metronome in the room, tick tock, tick tock, just allow it to go that bit slower. And you really get into this whisky much more successfully. I really enjoy, personally, malt mark first. Let's get the malt mark done and dusted. 89 out of 100, well-deserved malt mark for a great malt, Ralphie recommended. Now, this is one of these whiskies where it's readily available, it's giving a good descriptive label, it is not surrounded by pretentious marketing, it's bottled at a higher strength, it is self-evidently a natural coloured whisky, and it's available and it's affordable in relation to the quality of the experience you're buying. And this is one of the things that keeps my confidence and faith with the Scotch whisky industry. There may be some very standard bottles out there that don't actually deliver that much in relation to the price. But if you're prepared to do your homework and do your investigations online, you will find that there are a number of available standard bottlings that are generally affordable, that provide a really good single malt whisky experience in its own way, as good as a far more expensive older whisky. And that is the nature of Scotch. There is some cracking blends out there like Vat 69, still an affordable, mildly priced blended Scotch, which will give you total satisfaction. And it certainly gave me satisfaction when I had a wee glass a couple of weeks ago from a friend. Well, it's just less than a week ago, actually. But the single malt side of things, it could be Balvenie single barrel. It could be Highland Park 12-year-old. It could be Bunahavan 12-year-old. It could be Tobermory 12-year-old. It could be Ardbeg 10-year-old. It could be Talisker Distillers Edition. These are not old, hyped up, over-marketed, hugely priced official bottlings designed for the collector's market. These standard single malts are for the drinker, and for the price that they're asking, they provide as good a single malt experience as you could ever be looking for. Sure, old single malts, 20 plus years, you know, it's great to sip an old whiskey, and no matter how bad it is, folk will generally find it quite good. But it is a tendency, particularly with experienced whisky drinkers and collectors, is to actually overlook the beauties and the real rewards of some fairly available standard bottlings. And this is such a good example of that. And I do recommend it as such. It's a singular whisky. You may not like it in first contact, but it's rather like people we meet. Some people in life we meet, we don't get on with in first contact, and yet over time, when we get to know them better, our attitudes change. And I would suggest that particularly those with a sweet tooth, you know, who prefer sweeter whiskies, more accessible whiskies, that spend a bit of time with this, get to know it, and you will be rewarded. I am. Delicious. And slightly sweeter, cask sweeter, more vanilla. There's a little touch of icing sugar in there, but still the complex bitterness and sour duality, carrying the fresh fruit notes, herbal, and some touch of floral, makes this just delightful. I tell you what else is delightful. The bonaccordpub.com and scotchwhiskyauctions.com, because they sponsored me. Yes, they did. In case you haven't heard the news, and shame on you if you haven't, I was at Bonneville Salt Flats a few weeks ago, and I set a new world record in my 250 pushrod motorcycle. And there'll be more about that later once I get my trophy and sit it up in the shelf here. They need time to get it engraved. You know, that's the usual thing with world record trophies. And I'll also be cropping up at Glasgow's Whisky Festival in November. I've been invited over, and hopefully they'll let me set up the machine at the event so as that you can see it if you're there, and see my sponsors on the side of the fairing and all the rest of it. Wonderful stuff. So big thanks to the Bon Accord and Scotch Whisky Auctions. They had faith in me. Other whisky other whisky businesses did not. So they don't get a mention. Only my sponsors get a mention because they sponsored me. So talking of sponsorship, I hope you'll pay another sponsory visit to Whisky Review 597, which will be along next week. And I've got a really interesting old school single malt to review for you, which has been a bit of a dramatic journey over my tasting trips in the last month or so, because the bottle's changed that much, changed an awful lot. I'm going to tell you more about it when I review it in my next whisky review. What is it? Well, I'm not going to tell you. You're going to have to wait to find out. I'm Ralphie. This has been a Manx Bothy-based single malt experience. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I've enjoyed it. And do you know what, malt mates? It has been fun.